creatures great and small, all things wise and beautiful. You, O God, have made them all. Bless this time we have together, and thank you for it. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
So I'm going to do what Ken Shepherd does. Sit. And first, so what's that? Do I need to use a pulpit? Because you can't hear me otherwise.
No,
remember Bug Club? We might kick you out.
That's right. So we were talking about this in church. You got me. Got my eyes watering, John, here. Let's my mother, God bless her, and I consider it a great compliment to be in any category with your mom, John. I didn't know her, but I know how much you loved her and spoke with her. But my dear mother went to a church in Aurora. And in the church in Aurora, the pastor at the time was a really fine man. I really, really cared for him very much. I didn't go there much, but I went there sometimes with Mom. And after a while, I learned that he had been told that he had to leave the church in Aurora. And the reason for that was he didn't stand behind the pulpit, because somebody in the church had left money for the pulpit, and by golly, if he didn't use that pulpit, then he wasn't doing his job. And then there was some other rift with deacons or elders, and so he had to leave. And I felt badly about that. I thought, well, gosh, if he's not good enough to go to that church, I probably am not either. So thank you for having me in this church. And Lucy and I want to thank you for the time we've been here. You've given us a home. You've given us a family. And we have started our life together as a couple with our wedding year. And I'll never forget texting Ron Hinman, who's not here this morning, but I asked Ron, I said, would it be okay to use the church for the wedding? And he wrote back with all these exclamation marks, absolutely! You know, there was just the warmth and the welcome of all of you in our lives. And when I first came here, I especially was a pretty broken, lonely soul, having come back from Washington, D.C., and if you can imagine getting kind of beaten up in Washington, it had been a tough 3 years in some respects. Some good years, but coming back to take care of Mom was a new chapter. Thank you. I'd like to talk this morning with you just a little bit about this first reading in 1 Samuel. There's a little background to the story, and again, this goes back to mothers, and I don't think that fathers don't have an important place our lives. They absolutely do. My father was a great man, and I miss him dearly. But moms are important, and somehow moms have a really special place in each of our lives. My friends who are in prison, one person who has never given up on my friends in prison will be their mothers. Everyone else has gone away. Fathers, brothers, maybe sisters, but not mothers. Mothers never give up on their children. In this story, Samuel was an answer to prayer. You may remember at the beginning of 1 Samuel, Hannah and Elkanah, her husband's name, had no children. And so every year they went up to Jerusalem to have a special time of prayer, of dedication. And Hannah, who had no children, she just was, if you can imagine a mother's heart, she wanted children, desperately wanted children. And she was crying out to the Lord so much that Eli, the priest who was kind of in back of the temple, he looked at her later and he said, why do you come here drunk to the temple of the Lord? And she said, oh no, I'm not drunk. I'm desperately wanting a child. And I'm pouring out my heart before God saying, please give me a child. And he said, may your prayers be answered. And she went home, she and her husband, back to their home, and they had a son. And the son's name was Samuel. And then she brought the little boy back as a young boy back to the temple for Eli to raise Samuel in the temple of the Lord. She says, I've lent my son to God. Now, Kiki and Chris, can you imagine, you know, taking Van or Finn as a young boy to the church and saying, we're going to come back to see you, but you're going to live your life here in the church. And you're going to be serving the Lord with the priest in the church, you're going to just kind of grow up in the church. And Hannah, what a dear woman she was. Every year she went, and it says that she brought a little coat for her son Samuel. And this mom loved her son, and missed him greatly. Fast forward then to this time in the story. You know, Samuel's a young boy, maybe Van's age, maybe Finn's age. In the middle of the night, he hears Samuel, Samuel. It would be like Van or Finn or Piper. You know, hearing your parents call you in the middle of the night, and then you'd be running to their bedroom saying, what is it? What do you need? What's wrong? Well, finally, Eli, the old priest, realized that Samuel was being called of the Lord. And he told Samuel what to say. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Samuel goes on to give a prophecy that's a very hard prophecy for Eli to hear. For you see, his sons Hophni and Phinehas were rascals. They were scoundrels. And they were taking bribes of the people. They were not good men like the father Eli was. So Samuel gives this prophecy of God saying, your house will not last. Later, when the ark of God is taken in a war with likely the Philistines, they were the perpetual enemy of Israel, when Eli heard that the ark of God had been taken and his sons, Hophni and Phinehas, were both killed in the battle, he fell over. He was sitting on a chair. He fell over. He was an old man in his 90s. His neck broke, and he died. Samuel grows on.